Welcome to episode 2 of the KSP Quick Guides series. I'm Cruzin, and in this video I will cover everything you need to know about flying a basic aircraft in KSP. We'll cover basic flight controls and hotkeys, the user interface, and the all-important Nav Ball. After that, we'll head to the skies where I'll teach you the basics of taking off, flying with and without SAS enabled, and finally some non-quicksave inducing landing procedures. If you haven't watched the first episode, I highly recommend it as we build the plane we'll be using in this tutorial. These videos are meant to be short and sweet, so if I skip over anything or you have questions at the end, please feel free to leave a comment down below. There's a lot of stuff covered here, and if you want to skip anything, there will be quick links in the video description which will take you to specific topics. Alright, so let's dive right in and take a look at the user interface. If you're familiar with flying rockets or just playing KSP in general, most of this should seem familiar. In the top right corner of your screen, you'll see the Resources tab. If you click the tab, all the resources equipped in your plane will pop up. For now, the only ones that are useful to pay attention to are the electric charge, liquid fuel, and intake air. Clicking the Resource tab again will close the list. At the top middle of the screen, you'll find a ton of useful information. On the right edge, you'll see the three buttons. From top to bottom, they control the lights, landing gears, and brakes. These can be clicked individually or toggled using the U, G, or B keys, respectively. The big numbers in the middle represent your current altitude, which is how high in meters you are above sea level. Below that is an atmosphere visualization. This helps give you an idea of how thick the air is around you. As you gain altitude, the slider will move to the left, ending when you get all the way up into space. The dial on the right side is a very important gauge to watch. This indicates your vertical speed and can make or break your flights. We'll move to the top left corner, which houses the time warp controls. You can click on individual arrows to speed up time, or you can use the comma and period keys to adjust the warp one arrow at a time. On the bottom left, you'll see the staging controls. For our simple plane and most planes, your staging won't be very important. We'll cover this when we get into more complex designs, though. Below that, you'll see the input readouts for roll, yaw, and pitch. You won't find yourself looking at these at all while you're flying, aside from setting trim values, which we'll cover in a bit. The three buttons on the right edge can be ignored for now, but they control staging view, RCS controls, and map view. The bottom right-hand side of your screen shows your pilot. If you mouse over their face, two buttons will pop up. EVA makes the Kerbal exit the aircraft, while IVA lets you look inside the cockpit. You can zoom in and out and use the right mouse button to look around. Press C to pop back out. Now, for the single most important tool on your screen, the Nav Ball. I'm probably watching this more than I watch the scenery while I'm flying. Let's cover the edges first, then we can talk about the ball itself. On the left side is the RCS indicator. RCS is toggled by pressing the R key. Don't use this unless you're in space. If you need to use this while you're in the atmosphere, your ship probably needs to be redesigned. Below this is the throttle indicator. This is controlled by the shift and control keys. Shift raises the throttle while control lowers it. At the very top is your speed indicator. This gives a readout of your horizontal speed with respect to the surface. If you click this area, you can toggle back and forth between orbital and surface velocity. Let's stick to surface velocity for now. To the right of this is the SAS indicator. SAS is extremely useful as it helps you control your ship. Toggle this using the T key. Below this is the G-force indicator. It's fairly useless as of version 22. It can be cool to glance at though, to see how many G's you're pulling during a maneuver. Now for the nav ball itself. The ball is essentially a 3D compass that will tell you almost everything you need to know while you're in the air. First you'll notice the colors. These are intuitive as blue indicates the sky and brown indicates the ground. The line where these colors meet is the horizon line. In the center is the level indicator. It sort of looks like a plane with wings. This indicator stays still while the ball moves beneath it. Essentially, this marker represents where the nose of the craft is pointing. The lines and numbers on the ball might seem confusing at first, but they're actually pretty simple if you think of it like this. While looking at the horizon line, all the vertical lines are the same lines you'd see if you looked at a normal 2D compass. They go from 0 to 360, and there's a heading readout on the bottom to help with this even more. The horizontal lines that move up and down represent pitch and degrees. This ranges from negative 90 to 90 degrees, with negative 90 being straight down and 90 being straight up. The only other marker that is important for this video is the prograde marker. This green indicator tells you which direction your plane is actually traveling. The level indicator and the prograde marker do not tell you the same thing. To reiterate, the level indicator shows you where your plane is pointing, and the green marker shows you where your plane is actually going. You can see as I pitch the nose upwards that the level indicator is pointed in the blue region and is moving up the horizontal pitch lines on the nav ball. As I move around, watch the green prograde marker. As I move the plane, the level indicator moves away from the prograde marker, and then the prograde marker begins to follow until I stop moving and they line back up. As I roll the plane to the left and right, you can see how the nav ball reacts. Pretty much you can guarantee that if the green marker is above the horizon line, you're climbing. If it's below the line, then you're descending. While I'm turning, you can watch the heading readout on the bottom as my heading changes. I typically watch the vertical lines more than I do the numerical readings, though. That'll be enough to get you started with the nav ball for now, as that covers the basics. There's a small chance you might see this marker. If you see it, though, something has gone terribly wrong, and that's the retrograde marker. Somehow you're flying backwards. Let's head back to the runway and cover the controls really quick, and then we can work on flying. The keyboard keys you'll be using while you're flying are W, A, S, D, Q, and E. W and S control pitch, with S pitching the plane up and W pitching the plane down. A and D control yaw, with A moving the nose to the left, while D moves the nose to the right. Q and E control roll. Q rotates the plane counterclockwise, and E rotates the plane clockwise. And finally, we're going to put something in the air. Let's go over takeoffs quickly. If you followed along with the first episode, you should have ended up with a plane that can take off on its own. There are a couple reasons for this. The two major characteristics this plane has is a 5-degree pitch built into it when it's sitting flat on the ground. The other is that the rear wheels are relatively close to the plane's center of mass, which lets the plane rotate backwards off the ground easily. These two combine to let the plane lift off quickly and without any user input. Takeoffs are typically no-brainers as long as your plane is designed with these two aspects in mind. Some other problems you might run into is needing the entire runway to lift off, or wheelbarrowing, which causes the plane to tilt to one side or veer off the runway. I plan to make an entire video dedicated to helping you troubleshoot your planes, so I won't go into this now. All I'll say for now is try to add more lift and power, or add built-in pitch by mounting the rear landing gears higher up, or the front gear lower down, and then hold the S key the entire takeoff to keep the weight on the rear wheels. Alright, so let's go ahead and turn on the engine. You can press spacebar, which will trigger your first stage. With this design, this turns on my only engine. If you have a more complex design, you'll need to configure your stages. An alternative for now would be to right-click your engine and activate it that way. We'll cover action groups later when we start making crazier aircraft, but they are invaluable in the long run. Next, turn on SAS by pressing T, and make sure your brakes are disabled by looking at the brakes icon. If the light is off, you're good to go. Go ahead and throttle up. If your plane is veering off to one side, you can correct it by pressing A or D while your plane is still moving slowly, but don't try it once you've gained some speed. For a first run with the new plane design, I always try to take off without any keyboard input. If it doesn't lift off on its own by the time I'm halfway down the runway, I'll hold down the S key to pitch up to help it lift off. If everything is going well and you're airborne, go ahead and retract your landing gears by pressing G. As I said before, I'll cover troubleshooting pesky takeoff problems later. But for now, if you're having issues, leave a comment down below and I'll try to help you out in the meantime. Now that we're in the air, we can get to the interesting bits. SAS makes flying any halfway decently designed aircraft a breeze. It manages the plane's control surfaces and torque to keep you aimed in the direction you last pointed the aircraft. If you press any of the control keys, you'll see the SAS icon change, which means it's waiting for you to stop moving the craft before it locks in your position again. SAS isn't perfect, but it's extremely useful. If your plane is fairly twitchy and responds way too quickly to your commands, you can try turning on the precision controls by turning caps lock on. This tones down the input rate for your commands and makes the plane react much more slowly. This is very nice and I use it very often. Let's go ahead and get a little more complex here and turn off the SAS. I designed this plane with that intake on the top for a reason. The radial intake creates a lot of drag on the top of the plane. This isn't countered by anything else, so this will naturally make the plane want to pitch up without any corrections. Asymmetric drag is a concern you should think about when designing your planes, but small things like this are easily accounted for. We can correct this by using trim. If I press Alt plus W, it will adjust that zero point for my pitch. The zero point is the level of pitch the control surfaces keep when you aren't giving it any commands. If I add trim to pitch the nose down slightly, this will account for the plane wanting to nose up due to that intake. Now when I aim at the horizon, the plane won't pull up anymore. Flying without SAS can be tricky, but if you trim out any problems with your plane, it'll actually be pretty fun. If you want to reset any trim settings you've made, you can press Alt plus X to revert any changes. Now we can go over basic flight maneuvers. I suppose I should put out a disclaimer that my flight lessons do not qualify you to hop into your nearest two-seater Cessna and start cruising around. You probably already know the basics. You gain altitude by holding the S key, and you lose altitude by holding the W key. Turning is pretty simple as well. First we'll do what's called banking, which is rolling the plane to one side. Planes that have vertical stabilizers or are very agile can go for a full 90 degree bank, but most planes you'll fly can't go more than 60 to 70 degrees. This is because the nose will start to sag, which drops your prograde marker under the horizon. Too much bank and you'll start to lose altitude while you turn, which can be undesirable. So we'll make a 180 degree turn to the left, from a heading of 90 to a heading of 270 degrees. Press the Q key to bank left. How much is up to you, and you'll have to get a feel for how much you need based on your specific plane. Once you've got the bank set up, go ahead and press the S key. This is essentially the equivalent of pulling back on a joystick. This will pull the nose of the plane in the direction of the turn. Monitor your prograde vector while you turn. If it starts to drop below the horizon line, reduce your bank while rolling back slightly using the E key. Once I reach a 90 degree heading with my nose, I wait for the prograde marker to catch up. Once it is also at a 90 degree heading, I roll back to level and point back down to the horizon. Turn complete. I'll cover some advanced maneuvers you'd see fighters use in the next video, but for now, let's bring this thing in for a landing. This is by far the hardest thing you'll do with a plane, arguably the hardest thing you'll do in KSP in general when you're first learning. With a decent plane and a Jed-like attitude though, it can be done. I'll land at KSC first, and it's good to note that the landing strip at KSC is at 70 kilometers off the ground. Keep this in mind when you're getting ready to touch down. Your best friend while landing will be the vertical speed gauge. This will give you the best indication as to whether you're climbing or descending, and by how much. When touching down, try not to dip below the negative 10 meters per second mark on the gauge, or you'll likely hit the ground too hard and explode. You can see me adjusting my pitch, which is affecting my vertical speed. Find the right pitch for you and touch down gently. The use of landing gears is highly recommended. And that'll cover it for this video. I would have liked to squeeze in more info on landings, but this episode was running way longer than I was planning on. Too many logistics to cover before getting to the actual flying. If you need help, feel free to ask a question in the comments, or visit the forum thread for this series. There's a link in the description for that thread. Tune in next time where I'll cover some advanced flight maneuvers and answer some of your questions. Take it easy.